shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God. Come unto him. Come unto Jesus, and he will give you rest. Are you afraid? Do you have worry that controls you in your heart? Fear that just won't go away? I pray that during this time of testimony, of hope, I can help encourage you through the Word of God. My words cannot change any life, but these words of God Almighty can. And so thank you for your valuable time joining me as I strive to point you up to God, that you might know God. Do you know him? Through this horrific pandemic plaguing our country and the world, many people are searching for answers. Many people are searching for meaning. It begins with our relationship with God. Do you know him? Are you one with him? Much deeper than rich tradition or ritual, much deeper than religion. This is relationship. For Jesus said, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth and not have a rich relationship with God. Do you have a deep, rich, abiding, flourishing relationship with our God who has saved you, who has given his life for you? Do you love him? Is your faith simply passive? Do you sometimes feel like you're just kind of marking time and going through the motions? Or is your faith passionate? Do you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength? For the word says this, you must worship no other gods, but only the Lord. For he is a God who is passionate about his relationship with you. Isn't that humbling? God's heart beats for you. Does your heart beat for him? The great Saint Augustine said, our hearts are restless until they rest in him. Have you found him? Have you surrendered your life to him? Is he Lord over every single corner and crevice of your life? Is he Lord of all? Because you won't find that peace that passes all understanding until he is your Lord. Do you know him? Are you one with him? Because if you get this vertical relationship right, if you love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, then we have a chance to get these horizontal relationships right, to live a life of no regrets with one another. It begins with God, then extends horizontally to each other. This is a horizontal manifestation of that vertical relationship. We all might have regrets of things that we've done and we wish we hadn't done. And more often in life, as we go through the years, we look back and there may be regrets of omission, things we hadn't done that we wish we had. I wish I'd spent more time with our children. I wish I'd said I love you more. And so I hope that through what I share, this testimony of hope, it will challenge all of us to look through life through this lens of no regrets, particularly during this time when so many of us are sequestered to our homes and perhaps we have a bit more time on our hands. Are you using that time for worthwhile things, to draw closer to God, to draw closer to your family members? Will you do something that you might regret? I encourage you, look through it through the lens of no regrets. How do we do that? It only comes through the cross of Jesus Christ. Mighty is the power of the cross. For me, it's where I begin every morning. I get on my knees. I say, Lord, I need you. I need your grace and your strength to live this life of no regrets, to love one another, to forgive, to let go of those grudges. And so very simply, that's where I invite you today, is to the cross of Jesus Christ, to lay down your cares, your worries, your fears, your sorrows, your regrets, your sin, and let him wash it clean and begin this day anew. Well, my words cannot change any life, as I mentioned, but these words can. So I want to share the words of Almighty God in Scripture with you. Perhaps right now you feel similar to this passage in Lamentations. The thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words. I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Perhaps you've lost a loved one recently or due to this horrific pandemic. Maybe you lost your job or your home, your sense of security. You've lost your whole schedule and routine in life. It's turned upside down. We all have losses in life, right? Not one of us is exempt. Jesus said, in this world you will have troubles, but take heart, he said. I've overcome the world. So what do we do? Well, thank God for the Word of God. Thank God for the Bible. He says, yet I still dare to hope. Dare to hope. Can you do that with me? Dare to hope. It's countercultural. It's counterintuitive. Maybe your heart doesn't feel like it, but sometimes we have to tell our heart, go ahead, dare to hope, even when you don't feel as though there is hope, when you've lost all hope. That's the time when you've hit rock bottom. You've hit the rock at the bottom. You've struck the rock of ages. Dare to hope in him who can hold you and lift you up. So I pray that my story and this testimony of hope will give each one of us hope. All through Scripture, we see passages of people who had lost all hope. This one in 2 Corinthians from Apostle Paul, when he says, we think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia. Now recall, it was God's idea to send them to Asia, and yet they still had trouble. Isn't that something? Sometimes even though when we feel as though we're doing God's work, we get the sense it ought to be smooth sailing, but you haven't seen trouble until you become a Christian. That's when you got a bullseye on your back from the devil, and it's going to be even tougher. But God said he'll never leave you nor forsake you. But they were in a tough situation, a hopeless situation. We were crushed and perplexed beyond, we were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure. Have you been there? Maybe you're there right now. You're crushed and overwhelmed beyond what you think you can handle. In fact, we thought we would never live through it. Maybe you feel that way right now. You don't feel like you're going to live through this time. It's more than you can handle. It's more than you can endure. Well, we're in good company. They felt the same way. In fact, we expected to die. That's pretty dire circumstances. It's a fear many of us have, is a fear of dying. But when you're in Christ, you don't have to fear death. Death truly has no sting. But perhaps, like me, you've heard many people say to you, God will never give you more than you can handle. And I appreciate those sentiments, but I've come to believe a God always gives us more than we can handle, because he doesn't want us to handle it without him. Clearly, this was more than they can handle if they expected to die. Well, as we travel through this testimony of hope, we're going to hear how they had hope through it. And I want to encourage you, there is hope, even if you feel overwhelmed by your circumstances. Sometimes, for example, in the case of Lazarus, when Mary and Martha's brother Lazarus was dying, and Jesus didn't even respond for 2 days, sometimes he allows things to get worse so he can bring forth an even greater outcome than we could have ever imagined or prayed for. There is hope all through Scriptures, all through time. And so my story is one of many where there's hope. And this is where my story begins, is my parents. They were married in 1952 in Cincinnati, Ohio. And they truly lived a no-regrets marriage for over 60 years. Thanks be to God. I so appreciate their devotion and love for one another. In fact, on their 60th anniversary, I sang one of their favorite songs to them, and it went something like this. I love you, a bushel and a peck, a bushel and a peck, and a hug around the neck, a hug around the neck, and a barrel and a heap, a barrel and a heap, and I'm talking in my sleep about you, about you. 'Cause I love you, a bushel and a peck, you bet your pretty neck I do. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do
do.
A bushel and a peck. Fun little song, but so deeply in love for those 60 years. They wrote notes to each other. And some time ago, my father was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. They said, well, get your life in order. You might have just a few months to live. What do you do when you hear those words? You're going to die. You may not live through this. Much like Apostle Paul, he expected to die. The doctors thought he might have just a few months. But would you believe, by the grace of God and the power of prayer, my father went on to live over 36 months by the grace of God. And so we are thankful to spend all that time together Because he went through a lot in his life, four total knee replacements, two total shoulder replacements, a pacemaker. He was mostly spare parts. But through it all, he never complained. He had such a great attitude of gratitude. And that rubbed off on us, his caregivers, all those around him. And I encourage each one of us to do that, especially now. If you are sequestered at home, and one of the greatest things to help get through this time, one of the best antidotes to this adversity, is gratitude. Find things to be thankful for. Thank God you have a roof over your head. Thank God for the clothes on your back. Thank God for another meal, for another day. And you'll find the weights of this difficult time begin to lift, and your eyes begin to lift up to heaven. Each one of us has negatives in life, and perhaps now you feel it's a great big negative. But bring it to a positive by forming the cross. If you bring it to Jesus, he can transform that negative circumstance and bring forth a beautiful positive outcome. Take it to the cross and watch what he will do. And so I thank God for my parents and their legacy of faith and family. I'm the youngest of eight children. Grew up in Cincinnati, Ohio. And growing up, we'd all go to church together. We'd fill up an entire pew. And I called God Lord many, many times. But I hadn't yet made him Lord. There's a big difference. It's one thing to name him. It's another thing to know him. I knew a lot about him. A lot of people know of God. I had a lot of head knowledge, but it hadn't journeyed from my head down to my heart and out through my hands. And as a teenager, I started asking all these questions, saying, God, where are you? Are you real? Are you there? What does all this mean? Perhaps many of you are there right now. You're saying, God, are you there? Can you hear us? Are you real? I had those questions as a teenager. And it took me on a spiritual journey that brought me ultimately to my knees in a point of complete surrender with reckless abandonment. I said, Lord, I think I finally get it. You want my heart. You want all of me. Lord, I want all of you. Come, take me over. I give you my life. And it changed my life completely. In fact, I fell in love. I fell in love with Jesus. I fell in love with his word. I got my very first Bible. I started reading it. I started memorizing scriptures. And to this day, I'm still trying to memorize more and more scriptures all the time. I encourage you, read this book every single day. Don't just try. Do you try to eat? Well, don't feed your body and starve your soul. In fact, as a wise man challenged me, he said, no Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed. No Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed. What does that mean? Well, when you wake up in the morning, before you run to the iPhone, run to thy throne. Before you run to the TV, run to the Almighty. Before you run to the iPad, run to the great I Am. Before you fill your bowl with Fruit Loops or Frosted Flakes, fill your soul with the bread of life. Give them the best part of your day. Start with at least 10 minutes. Just spend 5 minutes reading some scriptures, maybe from the Psalms or the Gospel of John to begin with. And then spend 5 minutes in prayer. Just 5 on 5. And see where God will take that. At the end of the day, read some more scripture before you go to bed. Embrace your day with the good news of Jesus Christ from start to finish. There's enough bad news for the rest of the day. It's okay to catch up on the news and the updates and so forth, but don't dwell there. Dwell in his presence. In fact, this is all very scriptural. The very first chapter of Joshua says, meditate on it day and night. The very first psalm says, study it day and night. No Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed. You'll never regret it. And so I grew up there in Cincinnati. I studied piano as a youngster at the Conservatory of Music. I went on to study in college in Indiana for a couple years, and while I do like to play the piano, I also do like to eat. And so I transferred back to Cincinnati to study electrical engineering. Well, part of my curriculum brought me all the way to Boston, Massachusetts as a co-op student. I was helping to design computer chips at a high-tech company during the day as an intern. Well, on evenings and weekends, I got a job in downtown Boston at a sidewalk cafe playing the piano. Back when I thought having that hairdo would be really cool. Now, not so much. I pray they never come back. But thankfully, that doozy of a hairdo didn't deter a beautiful blonde from Kansas named Melissa from coming by and just plopping down on the piano bench next to me. Man, that never happened to me. I'm kind of a geeky, nerdy engineering type. I'm a shy, reserved introvert. I didn't date a whole lot. I didn't know what to say. I was shaking in my boots just trying to keep my fingers on the right notes. But suddenly we just started talking together. The words just started flowing. We started laughing together. She kept on laughing, probably because she kept on looking at my hair. But you know, it had to be a divine appointment. How else could you get a city slicker from Cincinnati, a country girl from Kansas, in the middle of downtown Boston? That would be God. And our Bible says in Matthew 6:33, if you seek him first, he'll give you everything that you need. That's why no Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed. Don't seek the person, the promotion, the prestige, the position, whatever it might be. Seek God. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added unto you. He'll take care of the rest. And so, lo and behold, a divine appointment when you least suspect it. Of course, it didn't hurt that Melissa reached into her purse, pulled out a $5 bill, and put in a tip cup you see right there. Ever since then, she said, you know what? That's the best $5 I ever spent. And so we quickly fell in love over an ice cream sundae. I thought, you know, I better marry this girl. So on a romantic riverboat cruise back in Cincinnati on the Ohio River on New Year's Eve, I popped the question. With the ring on her finger, she said yes right there. And 1 year later, we married in Cincinnati on New Year's Eve. And she said, I do. Even though I still had that mullet. After 7 long years of college, I finally graduated with 1 degree and 1 job offer. It was from California, and it was during a recession. So we thought, well, we better take it. So we packed up our covered wagon and moved west and started our lives together. And we always wanted a big family. And God bless us with children, but none of them ever came easily. Our first we named McKenna. She was over 2 weeks late. Took over 2 long days of tough labor and delivery to get here, followed by a C-section, because she was 9 pounds, 11 ounces, 22 inches long, and upside down. After all that, she still said, it's okay. Melissa said, it's okay. She's worth it. Yes, indeed, she is worth it. One day, McKenna came to me on a Saturday morning. She said, Daddy, can we build that birdhouse? I'd had the wood. I had the instructions. I just hadn't gotten around to it. And I had a whole list of things I was hoping to get done on that Saturday. You know, we feel good about our accomplishments and checking them off our list. I looked at my list and looked at our daughter, and I sort of hesitated for a bit and said, okay, McKenna, let's build the birdhouse. So I put down my agenda and picked up the saw. We cut the wood and put it together. She got out her colors and crayons and made a little welcome sign there at the bottom. And at the top, she drew a little arrow so the birds would know right where to go for the food. And we built a birdhouse, but more importantly, we made a memory. Take time to make memories with your loved ones, especially this time. If you are homebound, redeem this precious time with one another. There's always going to be more messages, more emails. You can always make more money. You can't always make more memories. Take time with one another. So when McKenna was about a year old, still there in California, I had to rush Melissa to the hospital. We had no idea what was happening. They admitted her for emergency surgery and transfusion. Turned out she was pregnant. Apparently the baby had lodged in one of her tubes and exploded. It was an ectopic rupture. Had I gone to work early that morning, I would have come home to a dead wife. Do you trust God? Do you trust God? Those little moments of life where you just happen to miss something by that much, or you just happen to turn right rather than turn left, or pause rather than lunge forward, and you see, looking back, that God spared your life. There is hope. God is there, even in those dire circumstances, when it doesn't make sense, when it hurts, and our hearts were hurting and hemorrhaging. We lost a baby. We tried to do everything we needed to do to be good followers of Christ, and yet life still happens. And now with half of Melissa's reproductive organs completely gone, without how are we going to have a big family? It's going to be twice as difficult going forward. But always remember, God is God. We are not. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. He has a final word. Well, lo and behold, within about half a year, we found out we were expecting again. After 5 years of California, we had had enough of the West Coast. We wanted to move back to the Midwest and be closer to family. And so we moved to Kansas City, where we bought our very first home. And a few months later, gave birth to our very first boy, whom we named Zachary. An 8-pound whopper, born completely naturally, no complications. Boy, we were thrilled. Until the next day when the doctors came and said, "We believe your son has Down syndrome." And bam, boy, that was like a baseball bat to my gut. There I was, buckled to my knees, saying, "Lord, I don't know how to do this. How do we raise a child with special needs? How do we deal with his autism, his colostomy bag, his cleft palate, teach him sign language to communicate? All these challenges, but all these blessings." We quickly realized that a disability really can be an opportunity to draw us closer to God and closer to one another. We learned a lot of great things. We also learned, don't ever feed your boy an entire bucket of blueberries. Or he might say to you too, "Mom and Dad, do I ever have a diaper for you?" I know, because I changed that one and I'll never forget it. A couple years later, we gave birth to another little big guy, another 9-pound whopper, another day and a half of tough labor and delivery, another C-section, but another miracle. We named him Nicholas. And then after our 10th wedding anniversary, Melissa said, "We're going to have another baby." We were thrilled to have number 4 on the way. But then 2 weeks later, we miscarried again. And boy, it's devastating. When it's part of your heart, part of your flesh, part of you. Perhaps some of you know what that feels like, to lose a child before birth. Maybe you've lost a child after birth, or a full-grown child. Perhaps your child is wayward. You don't know where they are or where their faith is. Maybe you've lost a sibling, a parent, a grandparent, a loved one. Maybe you've lost your job, your home, your health. Perhaps you've lost your whole family through what I've heard called the living death of divorce. How your heart must bleed every day. I can't begin to imagine. We all have losses in life. Not one of us is exempt. But Jesus said, "In this world you will have troubles, but take heart. I've overcome the world." There's thousands of ways to be hurt. There's only one way to be healed. That's through the cross of Jesus Christ. Take your hurts, your sorrows to the cross. Give them to him and watch what he'll do. There is hope. And that's what we did. We just took our broken heart to Jesus, said, "Lord, we just want a big family. Why is that so difficult? Why is it so tough to get them all here?" Well, we didn't receive a text or a fax or an email, but we have God's holy word. He speaks to us through his word, and also through his Holy Spirit, through unctions in our hearts. And so we just had a little prompting, adopt. Just a little unction, adopt. And so we just went for it. We went to an innocent informational meeting there in Kansas City at an adoption agency. And with these tears rolling down our cheeks, we knew this is for us. Long story short, 11 months later, we're on a 747 airplane, flying from San Francisco all the way to Beijing, China. Because we heard about a little orphan girl that nobody else wanted, all because she wasn't perfect, all due to a heart defect. She was special needs. We thought, well, we have a special needs boy. Let's go get a special needs girl. She's perfect for us. So I'll never forget coming back to the Kansas City airport and crossing a jetway to greet the rest of our family and holding in our arms this beautiful bundle of joy. We thought, oh, how could nobody want her? She's perfect. She's beautiful. She's spicy. And yet there's at least 143 million orphans on this planet right now. And it's up to us as a body of Christ to help to care for them in some way. We thought, well, we got to start with just one at a time. So right away, she was part of our family, just one of the gang. Of course, we could never quite make all 4 smile at once. You know how it can be sometimes? You get out the cookies, the toys, you try to sing a song. It doesn't always work, does it? Life is not perfect, but life is precious. We learn particularly by having 2 special needs children how life is sacred. And I implore each of you parents and grandparents to love your children with all you've got. Don't let a day go by without letting them know how much you love them. Tell them you love them. Use the words. Don't just assume they know it, but tell them. After all, what did Jesus say? Jesus said, I give you one commandment, that you love one another. He said, as the Father loves me, so I love you. He used the words, right? He demonstrated fully on the cross, and he used the words. How much more should we? To live a life of no regrets, tell each other that you love each other. I know there's those days we can all get on each other's last nerves. Perhaps everyone being cooped up at your home right now, you're experiencing some of that. But for me, I like to just, at the end of the day, get down on my knees, let all that tough stuff roll off my back, and just raise my hands and thank God for another day. Every day is truly a gift. That's why it's called the present. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed and broken. We are perplexed, but we don't give up and quit. This pandemic doesn't make sense. It confounds us, but we don't give up. Others make us suffer, yes, but God never abandons us. Always remember that. We get knocked down, yes, but we get up again and keep going. Why? Because there is hope. Jesus, as he carried the cross, fell and buckled under the weight of it. But did he stop there? No, he got up again. He kept going. So he could give us the grace and the strength to endure our own cross. Jesus didn't suffer and die on a cross so we wouldn't have to suffer. He showed us how to suffer. I thank God that he did.
Flash floods in Kansas Saturday night. Four young children were killed in one car.
The rising waters trapped the family's minivan against a highway barrier until it broke, plunging the vehicle into a creek three stories below.
Robert Rogers, who 2 weeks ago lost his wife and all four of his small children in a raging flash flood across Kansas Highway.
Have you asked yourself again and again, why was I left here? Why was I spared?
Well, I believe it was nothing short of a miracle. God is not a taker of life. God loved the world so much that he gave. I believe he chose to spare me so that I might be a beacon of hope. A banner for families so that we might reach others through this experience and help them to cherish their children and families.
Hug and kiss them every day, every morning and every evening. Tell them over and over how much you love them. Snuggle with them at bedtime. Place your hand on their heads and bless them every day as I did.
No hug is unimportant. A very moving soliloquy yesterday from a father who has lost so much.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all my fear is gone. Because I know he holds my future and life is worth the living just because Jesus lives. Do you believe that? Really deep down here, not just words of a beautiful hymn, but truly the essence of our faith. That even if your whole world is washed away, you still have a life worth living. Because it's built on the rock of Jesus Christ. I could not possibly be here today and share my story if it weren't for my faith. The Bible says the wise man is the one who hears these words and puts them into practice. So when the rains come down and the rivers rise and the wind beats against that house, it will not fall, for it's built on the rock. There is hope if you build your life upon the rock of Jesus Christ, of his promises and his word. Now, my faith didn't just evaporate the pain. It still hurts. I still cry. I still grieve. I still look up at the stars and whisper their names. I still trust God. My faith, it's very simple. I believe this. I believe the words in this book. Sometimes faith is simply acting as though God is telling the truth, even when what you see doesn't line up with what he says. Because God cannot lie. He always tells the truth. His mighty word. My faith that on that night when all six of us in our vehicle were washed off the Kansas Turnpike and plunged into this deluge, somehow I was washed ashore and they took me by ambulance to a nearby hospital in Emporia, Kansas, while they began a search and rescue for the rest of my family. In the middle of the night, an officer to chaplain came to my room with their hats on their chests. They said, "Robert, we found your minivan. It was upside down on a mile and a half from the freeway." They said three of our young children were still in their car seats, and they are dead. "And Robert, we need to ask you to identify their bodies." What do you do? It's every parent's worst nightmare. All my blood just went to my toes. I felt numb. At first, I couldn't even cry. They slowly led me down this hallway to the emergency room and turned left and pulled back the drape. And there before me was Zachary, 5 years old, a little big guy with Down syndrome. Nicholas, 3 years old, our buddy boy. Alina, our precious little sweet pea from China, still only 1 year old. We only had her for 8 short months. Never got to celebrate her birthday or Christmas together. And suddenly the floodgates of my tears just burst forth and I collapsed over each of their bodies and stroked their wet hair and cried and groaned and wailed from my gut like I was going to throw up again. And somehow I believe only by the Holy Spirit, with one hand on each of their chests, I raised my other hand up to heaven. I said, "Lord, into your hands I commend their spirits." The very words of Jesus on the cross, just before he breathed his last, exemplifying his lifetime of surrender. And so must we. As followers of Christ, one of the hardest things to do is to surrender all. And yet he's not Lord at all if he's not Lord of all. After all, we own nothing. Everything, everyone we have is on loan, a gift from Almighty God to be cherished. How often do we sing, "Jesus loves me, this I know. Little ones to him belong." They don't belong to us. A few hours later, they came to my room again, said, "We found McKenna." She apparently caught on a barbed wire fence just a short distance from a minivan. They had to go down a long hallway once again, identify Daddy's first little girl. She just turned 8 only 2 weeks before. We had a fabulous birthday party and everything. And for days, we prayed and hoped they would somehow find my wife, Melissa, intact. On the third day, they found her body, 2 miles from the freeway, in this retention pond that had tripled in size from all the floodwaters. I had to identify my wife of over 11 years. What do you do? Where do you run? What holds you up at a time like that? It can only be the power of God. The mighty power of his word that holds everything in place, that holds the planets in their orbits, can also hold your world together. Even now, even when it looks so bleak and hopeless, there is hope. God can hold your world together as somehow he held my world together. His word says in the book of Romans, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Don't give up on God. Stay on your knees in prayer. Don't lose your faith. Allow this time to refine and prove your faith. And be joyful. That's not just painting on a happy face or being happy clappy. It's not a fake facade or a cellophane kind of faith. It comes from deep down here, an abiding trust and joy and a hope of eternal life. And that we know that even though we walk through that valley of a shadow of death, we can fear no evil, for he is with us. Trusting that somehow God can cause everything to work together for good and not for evil. For those who love him are called according to his purpose. Now we may or may not ever see it in our lifetime. But by God's grace, we are privileged to see some goodness come from this very soon after the flood. People who contacted me and said, Robert, I've been struggling with Christ for years, but when I saw your strength and courage on television, you gave me the strength and courage to give my whole heart to Christ. Praise the Lord. Even one more soul for God's kingdom. And would you believe in the wreckage of our minivan, they uncovered our camera. We'd use that night at the wedding and reception. You can see some of the candles behind us and so forth. It's a miracle they even found our camera. It's another miracle they were able to develop the roll of film in that camera. But the biggest miracle of all is that all four of our children are actually looking at the camera at once and smiling. That virtually never happens, right? I have that picture on a beautiful blue bookmark that perhaps some of you already have. If you'd like to contact me, I'll gladly send you one just so you can see a picture of hope and perhaps share it with someone who needs some hope. God just says, trust me. Trust me in your times of trouble. We all know it to be true, right? But do we do it? Trusting God is like walking out on a limb when the only thing you've got to hold on to is your faith. Right now, when we feel perhaps immobilized, perhaps you feel stuck in your home and you can't go to work and can't earn a living, say, Lord, what do I do? We have no other choice but to trust him. It's very simple. It's not easy, but it is very simple. Trust me in your times of trouble. And he promises two things. I love this. Number one, he says, I will rescue you. I will. Some way, somehow, I'll rescue you. He's going to rescue us through this in his perfect timing and in his way. He rescued my family that night. They got to go to heaven. Now, who's more blessed? Better is one day in his courts than 1,000 anywhere else. I felt as if all six of us were going to heaven. I was tumbling in the water. I couldn't see. I couldn't breathe. I was ingesting the floodwaters. I was drowning. And yet, strangely, at that moment of near death, it felt very peaceful, as if God had his hands around all six of us, lifting us up to heaven. If you or someone you know has had a near-death experience, you can probably relate. But somehow I was washed ashore. I don't know how, but by the grace of God, here am I sharing my testimony of hope with you this day. I will rescue you. Now, it may not be your way. It may not be your timing, but it'll be God's way. It'll be good. That's number one. Number two, he says, and you will give me glory. What? Wait a minute, Lord. You sure you put the right word there? Glory? Really, Lord? Have you seen my life lately, God? I'm a mess. I'm a wreck. How are you going to bring glory through this? Well, you know, God can bring forth from your story, God can bring forth great glory. Out of your mess, God can bring forth a mighty message. Out of every great test, like the one we're going through right now, can come forth a great testimony. What's the key? It's how we respond. Life is about 10% what happens to you, about 90% how we respond to what happens to us. Will you trust him? Will you stay in faith? And so that's what I just did my best to do, was to respond in faith, to answer the call of so many around our country, even around the world, who invited me to come and to share the hope of Christ and God's good news of the gospel through our family story. I thought, I don't know what I'm doing. I've never done this before. I'm a shy, reserved introvert. This has always been my least comfortable spots, in front of people, behind a microphone. But God often uses our weakness to display his strength. That's how you know it's him and not me. I also traveled around the world to places like Haiti, to Russia, to India, after that horrific tsunami that claimed the lives of hundreds of thousands of people through turbulent waters, much like what happened to my family. And if I can offer one word that's helped me to heal the most these past years, it's just one word: serve. Serve. It sounds kind of backwards, doesn't it? You might feel like when I'm in pain, I need others to pour into me. But what I found is you empty your life and pour into others, God's going to fill you up. It's in giving that you receive. You're going to reap what you sow. Even if you're sequestered at your home, find a way to serve. Call someone. Encourage them. Pray for them. Write them a note. If you have some groceries or can help someone else out with some, put them on the front porch or do what you can. But just find some way to serve. We are saved by the blood of Jesus in order to serve here on this earth, to do good works which God prepared for each one of us to do. What I found is as you look into the eyes of those you serve and you see their hearts, it'll help change your heart. It'll help transform your heart to become more like the heart of Christ. Through my passion for these orphans, I also began a foundation I call the Mighty in the Land Foundation, with a big vision to sponsor or begin at least 5 orphanages around the world in honor of my 5 Heavenly Family members. And one by one, he's been bringing that to pass. In 2006, we dedicated in Russia the Melissa Home, then in Rwanda, Africa, the McKenna Home, in India, the Zachary Village, in Uganda, Africa, the Nicholas Home, in downtown Beijing, China, Alina's Home, back in Uganda, Hope Village, in Haiti, Joy Village, in Kingston, Jamaica, the Bethlehem Home. In fact, since we began this foundation, we've given over $536,000 to help care for orphans and special needs children around the world, including here in the United States as well. Our goal was 5 homes. Now we've helped to fund or sponsor 8 homes. Now, I can understand a lot of numbers, but I cannot understand those numbers. It is way over my head. It has nothing at all to do with me. It has everything to do with God. Look what God can do. If you offer him your heart, give him your tears, whatever you have, it may just be a few loaves and fishes, maybe a broken alabaster jar. Like King David, all he had was 5 stones. All he used was 1. But look how God brought forth a mighty victory through that 1 stone. Give him what you have, even right now. If you feel like you don't have much at all to offer, give him your heart, give him your tears. And watch how he'll bless it, multiply it, make it more than what it is, transform it, and use it mightily for his kingdom around the world. Oh, God's so good. He's so rich in mercy. I'm so honored to be a part of their lives in some way. I've also been very honored to have partnered with Focus on the Family. As I literally scraped out the walls of my heart and put them on the pages of his book called Into the Deep. Into the Deep, one man's story of how tragedy took his family but could not take his faith. I may have lost my family, but I didn't lose my faith, my joy, my hope, and this book tells how. A lot of people have read it in just a few hours. They've told me later, Robert, I couldn't put it down. It's helped change the way I live my life. And do you know why? Not because of me, but because of him. And because I filled this book with this book. It's full of scripture. And this is what truly will change your life. If you need one of these, you just thought of somebody who couldn't be here who needs one, please feel free to contact me on my website. You're welcome to order one if you like. If you can't afford it, I'll be glad to send it to you. Just contact me in some way on the website, and I'll do what I can to get these to you. There's a Spanish version available as well, if that's helpful to anyone. We're all going through a test. Life is a test. Right now it's a tremendous test. And so it prompted me to write a book recently called Pass the Test, How to Endure the Fire of Affliction and Emerge Like Gold. We're going to get through this pandemic. It may feel like extreme adversity and great affliction, but God wants to refine us and come forth like gold. This is a thin book, only about 100 pages, but it's full of over 100 scriptures that have helped me that I pray will help you. If you like it or need one, just let me know. And after my family died, into the cameras I said these words. I said, I have no regrets. Not because we lived a perfect life by any means, but we lived a purposeful life. That day they died, I'd hugged them all. I told them I loved them. Our hearts were clear. Thanks be to God. But since then, so many people have said to me, Robert, how'd you do that? What'd you do to live that life with no regrets? And so it prompted me to put down words in another book I call 7 Steps to No Regrets, just 7 key principles of living a life of no regrets with God and with one another. It's full of stories of all that God has done since the flood. It's full of scriptures that at least help steer your life in the right direction. If you need one of these, just let me know, and I'll be glad to get one to you. And then just because people ask me, Robert, how'd you get through it? What worked for you? I wrote a book called Rise Above. Rise Above, How to Heal the Hurts and Overcome the Worst. Because when you're that one going through the valley, it's the worst, right? Every loss is uniquely devastating when it's your loss. This is also a thin book, about 100 pages, but it's full of well over 100 scriptures that have helped me that I pray will help you. If you need one of these, just let me know as well. I also have a video of our family story that you're welcome to avail yourself of, and some music CDs, one of me singing some hymns and original compositions and some other peaceful piano instrumentals. Just let me know, because I do this full time. This is what I do. I have degrees in engineering and a bachelor's in electrical engineering. I have a master's in business. I could easily have a high-paying, high-tech job right now. But what I do full time is share this message of hope to all who invite me. At the present time, we're not able to travel, and so I'm bringing this message to you online. But once we're free to travel again, I'd be honored to come and to share. My testimonies cost me everything. I charge nothing. I don't have an agent. I don't charge fees. In fact, on a bookmark at the bottom, there's a phone number. That's my cell phone. You call that, you get me. I try to be very accessible and very transparent. Why? I'm passionate for the Lord. I want to help turn all our hearts to God, to ignite them for Jesus. I'm also passionate for families. I want to help turn parents and children's hearts back to one another by challenging us all to live this life of no regrets, starting today. But I could use your help. Could you help me, please? Just 2 simple things. It'll only take a tiny bit of time. Number one is, if a story has impacted your life, you just thought of your church, another city, state, that could benefit, just connect with me online if you like. If you contact me another way and I send you some materials, I send you a brochure as well that you could pass along to your pastor or another church or organization or school, prayer breakfast, that others might encounter Christ and experience Jesus through our family story. That's my heart's desire. That's number one. Number two is most important. Pray. Could you please pray for me? I need your prayers. Don't we all need prayers? So many of us are praying extra right now, special. But could you pray for me just one time a month? What's your birthday? Just pray on that day every month, just 12 times a year. Real simple way to remember it. And if you'd like to commit to pray, just let me know. And I'll be glad to send you one of these green wristbands that has my motto on it, to know God and live a life of no regrets. It's a reminder to pray, but it's more for you. A reminder to know God more each and every day, to live that life of no regrets. It's a reminder of no Bible, no breakfast, no Bible, no bed. It's a reminder that if your child comes to you and says, Mommy or Daddy, can we do that thing we've been putting off for so long? That you do put down the phone or the tablet, the screen, you just turn it off. You look at them eyeball to eyeball and say, yeah, you know what? Let's do that right now. Let's have that banana split, by golly. Let's not wait for someday. This day is someday. We aren't guaranteed the next 5 seconds. And during this pandemic, we are all deeply reminded of that. more than ever. This picture was taken July 2003. 7 weeks later, August 30th, McKenna was dead. And I thank God that a guy like me just happened to make a no-regrets decision that Saturday morning and build a simple little birdhouse with our daughter. I still have that birdhouse now in my backyard. I still cherish that memory in my heart. Today counts. This time with you, your time with your families, it's precious. How we respond to this trial, to this time of testing, and how we respond to afflictions is what is key. And the Bible gives us direction. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure. This is Apostle Paul. And we thought we would never live through it. In fact, we expected to die. Remember, they were in a hopeless situation. So how did they respond? What was their key? What was their secret? But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves. We stopped relying on ourselves. How much have we all been reminded these past few weeks during this pandemic and being sequestered? How quickly life can change. Our health, the economy, groceries, basic necessities, how much we need to rely on God. We learned to rely on God. See, God is most interested in our development. God desires our development. Satan desires our downfall. But allow God to use this time of testing to refine and develop your faith, to draw it forth into something even greater. We learn to rely on God who raises the dead. God's power lives within you if Jesus is your Lord, your Savior, your everything. Remember that He will see you through some way and somehow. There is hope. For those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. You may have a lot of sorrow now. May have a lot of despair. None of this may make any sense. I believe one day we're going to be able to look back and see the fingerprints of God as He saw us through this difficult time. And we're going to be able to reap joy and sing with joy. For Lord, You've allowed me to suffer much hardship. And couldn't we all say amen to that? We could probably all agree with that right now, especially. Yes, Lord, You've allowed me to suffer a lot of tough stuff. But I love this. You will restore me to life again and lift me up from the depths of the earth. Isn't that good news? That's what Easter's all about. That's what the resurrection's all about, how God reached down and lifted up His own Son. And if He lives within you, He wants to lift you up, to carry you through this time, and to bring you forth better than ever before. He's done it all through time, all through Scripture. In fact, usually when it's worst, when it's darkest, boom, that's when light and hope dawns for the upright. It's always darkest right before the sunrise. Remember Job? He had everything, and then he lost everything. He lost his health. He lost his job, his career. He lost all 10 of his children, 7 boys and 3 girls. But he didn't lose hope, and God was faithful to him. In fact, God blessed him double of everything he had lost, including double the family. He had 10 children in heaven. God blessed him with 10 more on this earth. 7 boys and 3 girls, much like before. In fact, the Bible says that from Job's experience, we see how the Lord's plan finally ended in good. Don't you love that? Don't you love a good book, a good story with a happy ending? I do. God is a God of happy endings, heaven ultimately. But even the seasons and chapters of your life on this planet, even this difficult season when we're all sequestered to our homes, don't squander this sequester. It can have a good ending if you trust Him. If you surrender your heart, your life to Him and free fall into the arms of Jesus. Could I prove it to be true? Would that be okay? Okay. Look at this next picture. Back in 2006, a beautiful girl said to a guy like me, I do. Her name is Inga. She's not from Sweden. She's from Indiana. So now I'm a Hoosier. And thereafter, God blessed for the beautiful son. We named him Ezekiel Thomas. And then God blessed us with a gorgeous daughter. We named her Estella Eve. After a very traumatic miscarriage, a little stillborn boy, about 5 inches long and 5 months along, we had to bury him. It was awful. But then God blessed us again with a beautiful son. We named him Leo. And would you believe another time he blessed us with a gorgeous daughter we named Lola Elizabeth. Behold the hand of Almighty God. Is anything impossible with God? Nothing's impossible with God. You see, 16 years ago, my beautiful wife and two mighty sons and two lovely daughters died in that flash flood in Kansas. Now somehow, God has graced me with a beautiful wife and two mighty sons and two lovely daughters. How is that possible? But by the sheer grace of Almighty God. Is it no wonder my knees hit the floor every morning? I assure you they do. Because I don't deserve them. I'm nothing. I'm just dust and ashes. But because I know God through his son, Jesus Christ, he calls me son. Look how much he loves me. Look how much he loves you. He gave his only son that you might have life and have it more abundantly. God loves you. There's nothing you can do to stop that love. Would you believe in him and receive him completely into your heart? I love my family beyond what words can express. I cherish this time at home with them. We home educate our children. I work out of my home office. Our children now are ages 12 and under. So we have a very loud and active household. But it's become even more loud and active recently because not long ago we found out we're expecting again. And so, in September of 2018, God bless us with a beautiful son. We named him Solomon Gideon Rogers. God is good. Look what God can do above and beyond we could possibly imagine. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who trust in him. There is hope. By the way, we can't always get all of our children to look at the camera once and smile either. But thank God we can laugh. We need to laugh. We need joy. We need hope. Well, let me wrap it up with one last image of God's amazing attention to detail in our lives. Because God truly is in the details of life. See, after my family died, I had to bury all five of them at once. There's hardly any words even to begin to try to describe that. They're at the cemetery near Kansas City. But at the cemetery, after the service, I felt compelled to release these balloons. One by one, I didn't quite want to let them pluck out of my fingers, but they rose up to heaven, and it was beautiful and awful all at once. We came back to my empty, hollow home. I lived there for nearly 3 years alone. It took a long time to go through all their belongings and everything. Many nights I would just curl up into a little ball on our children's beds in a fetal position and just cry myself to sleep. I went through counseling, went through a lot of tough stuff. But on that first day back with my parents and our siblings at our side, we're just clinging to each other for dear life. We just happened to wander into the laundry room of all places. And on the wall was this calendar my daughter McKenna had made as a school project a year before the flood. It was still in August, but now it was September, Saturday, September 6th, the day of the funeral. And so we just happened to flip it up, and our jaws hit the floor. Because there's McKenna going to heaven. She never drew herself in any of the 12 months, but this one out of all 12. She's holding balloons. I just released balloons to the cemetery. She's holding six balloons. Six people died that night of the flood. She's got a big smile on her face. Her feet are off the ground. This woman driving that bus, Melissa was driving her van that night when we hit the floodwaters. There's two boys and a girl still in their car seats on the bus. Our two sons and youngest daughter were still in their car seats when they found our van later that night. And if you notice, I'm nowhere in the picture. It's just the five of them. And off the right is a stoplight she colored red, as if that's the end. Well, if that's not enough, remember that last roll of film they miraculously uncovered from the wreckage of our minivan and our camera? They also came out with this picture we'd snapped after the bride and groom left the reception. And all the balloons from the car were on the pavement, and of course our kids were playing with them. And lo and behold, there's McKenna in virtually the same exact pose as she drew a year before. This has taken hours before we hit the flash flood. But look, her arms are up to heaven, balloons in each hand. She's got a big smile on her face. Her feet are off the ground. And you see what's right behind her? There's that stoplight, just like in her picture. You put those two next to each other, and friends, this is no coincidence. This is a God incident. This, it's real. God is real. This book, it's real. It's not just a bunch of stories. It's the Word of God. It's not just words about God. It's the very voice of God in print. In fact, it's one big love story between God and you. He wants your heart. Heaven is real. And hell is real. And you will spend eternity in one of those two places. That's the main reason I'm bringing this message of hope to you. That none of us misses it. That one day we don't hear those words, "Depart from me, I never knew you." But rather that we hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come on in." If today were your last day, would you have no regrets? Do you know him? Are you one with him? Jesus asked Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" Not who do others say, but who do you say? How you answer that question determines everything. Peter said, "I believe you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." He said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even though he dies." Then he asked Martha, "Do you believe this?" That's a question for you and each of us today. Do you believe that? That even if we die, we live in Christ. I pray you make that choice to receive him completely, accept him as your Savior, and surrender your life into his hands. I'd like to share a song with you that's very near to my heart. One that I composed for my daughter McKenna, from a father's heart. Because I had a lot of questions, you know. Lord, oh, why? Why did I live and they died? I don't get it. I'm their protector. I'm their provider. It doesn't make sense. But I was so comforted when I realized their last breath on earth was followed immediately by their first breath in heaven. You taught me what it's like to be a daddy, to be invincible in your eyes. You taught me what it's like to be the king of our castle and whisk my little princess away. But what was it like to break the bonds of death into life? And what was it like to breathe in your last breath and not die? What was it like to pierce the earthly veil to heaven? Can you teach me somehow what is heaven like? You taught me what it's like to kiss my princess goodnight. But when the rain came, I couldn't save your life. McKenna, what was it like to break the bonds of death into life? And what was it like to breathe in your last breath and still not die? What was it like to pierce the earthly veil to heaven? Can you teach me somehow? What is heaven like? Oh, and what is it like to walk through heaven's door? And what is it like to dance on streets of gold? What is it like to savor heaven's ice cream? What is it like to hold Jesus and just gaze in his eyes? What was it like to pierce the earthly veil to heaven? Can you teach me somehow? Can you show me somehow? Darling, teach me somehow. What is heaven like? Just like that, life can change in an instant. We just don't know, do we? Every death, every funeral, even this pandemic reminds us just how fragile life is, how thin the veil is between this world and the next, between time and eternity, between this opportunity for conversion and that moment of judgment. So I pray that each of us is changed by this testimony of hope. Changed to turn our lives away from sin and back to the Lord. To turn our lives away from the world and all its distractions and back to our families. I love that message they left on my phone just 2 weeks before the flood. I just happened to save it. But did you notice they never said goodbye? They just said, "Goodnight, Daddy. I love you." And really, that's the truth. Because when we're in Christ, there is no goodbye. It's just good night. Yes, weeping endures for the night. We cry a lot of tears, but joy comes. Joy comes in the morning. Because God is faithful. He says, "I will be faithful to you. And you will finally know me as Lord." Do you know him as Lord? Over every corner, crevice, and facet of your life, is he Lord of all? If today were your last day, would you have no regrets? I'd like to pray with you. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the blessed name of your Son, Jesus, thanking you for another day on this planet. With all that transpiring around us, we're reminded how fragile life is, and that none of us is guaranteed tomorrow. So Lord, right now, we surrender. We surrender our hearts, our wills, our very lives to you and to your hands. We say, come, enter in. Lord Jesus, I believe you died on the cross and you rose from the grave, and I accept and receive your free gift of salvation. Lord, do within me what you must, so you can do through me what you will. Lord, tear our hearts where they need to be torn. Break our hearts for what breaks yours. Mold us into your image, so that as we emerge through this pandemic, we would come to know you, to love you, to serve you, and to follow you all of our days with all of our might. We pray these things through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So here's my prayer for you as we depart, the scripture from Romans. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace amidst all the chaos around us as you trust in him. Why? So that you may overflow with hope. Others around you need the hope of Christ. We cannot give away that which we don't possess. You'll never have peace and hope around you until you get peace and hope inside of you. It comes through relationship with Jesus Christ by the grace of God. I'd like to conclude with one last hymn. It's very beautiful. And perhaps it'll resonate with where you are this day. It's called God Leads Us Along. In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the waters cool flow, bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives us all in the night season and all the day long. Sometimes on the mount where the sun shines so bright, God leads his dear children along. Sometimes in the valley, in darkest of night, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. In the night season and all the day long. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and heal you, keep you and protect you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you peace and favor all the days of your life, in Jesus' name, amen. If I can be of help to you, please do contact me at the website or by Facebook, and I'd be glad to come, and when we're all able to visit, if you're able to support this ministry, I would appreciate your support, especially during this time. This is a nonprofit ministry, and God has met our every need for the past 16 years, so we bring the good news of Christ to others. Thank you. God bless you.